I had decided, by the time we had been living in Texas a bit, but when I decided to run, I went to my wife and said that I was going to do that. And she says, what in the world would you want to do that for? And I said, well, I just want to talk about economic policy. I think they're, you know, doing dumb stuff. And there were only three Republicans in all of Texas at that time. And it was a very Democratic state. And she said that she didn't think that was a good idea because that was dangerous. And I said, well, how in the world could it be more dangerous running for Congress? Nobody's going to listen to me anyway. She said, no, you could end up getting elected. And I said, no, that's not possible. And she had realized after I was moving down there and I was in the service, went back and finished my training, came back and finally settled in Texas. And it was a very good medical practice. I was very, very busy. But I wasn't elected that first time, but I remained interested. And it goes to prove you, America's a great place. Almost anybody can get elected to Congress. So I hope it remains that way. And right now, this year, it looks like there may be some long-time professional incumbents that might find out that they're going to have to leave. So as long as we have that opportunity, I think we should take advantage of that. I'm a strong believer in civil disobedience. I really believe it's a great principle. Whether it's the type that Gandhi practiced or Martin Luther King practiced or others that practice it during the time of slavery. And I think that when the laws are bad, they should be changed, and they should be changed any way you can. Now, I haven't personally participated in civil disobedience. I guess I'm chicken or something. But I admire people who do. But maybe it helped me push me into saying, if there's still an opportunity where we can participate in the system, maybe that's the way we should do it. I'm not convinced that this country won't reach a point if we don't turn this around where there will be a lot more civil disobedience. Matter of fact, I'm just wondering how long it's going to be till some of the states decide to practice the 10th Amendment. And maybe somebody will look up that old term nullification and decide that we don't have to follow all these laws. But, you know, I think a lot of that is possible, but I think it's going to come in a more de facto way because the courts are never going to rule in favor of the 10th Amendment and nullification. But if the system fails with a dollar failure, that's chaos. That's trouble. But that doesn't mean that everybody just quits. Everybody then really has an obligation to look after themselves any way they can. Already people are doing that. There's a lot of people who have dropped out of the system. But that, to me, isn't the answer. But a lot of them will do it on principle and stand on it. Principle. Here we have a Secretary of the Treasury. I think when he was being nominated, they found out that he didn't obey all the tax laws. So we made him in charge of the IRS. And then we find somebody else who, on principle, challenges the tax code, and they're 100% right on their arguments, and they put him in prison for life. I mean, that isn't, quite fair. And yet, that principle, I really believe in it, but I believe it's going to grow. But in the meantime, for me, I want to do my best to take advantage of a system where we can still participate. We can still come to a group like this and talk. But there are some of the changes that are occurring, especially in the post 9/11 atmosphere, that really worries me. It worries me about how much our CIA is involved overseas. And this week, I could not believe a headline that said the president was considering the legality of assassinating an American citizen. Now, this is true. It's true. He was born in this country. And he's a Muslim, and he's identified to be with people who don't like us. So they want to declare him an enemy combatant, which they can do by, like, the Attorney General, the President. Oh, he's an enemy combatant, and therefore he has no rights. Now you say, well, yeah, but he's a terrorist. Well, no, he is maybe a suspect, and nothing has been proven, and he might be a bad guy. But is that the way you take care of bad guys, talking in the White House about assassinating this guy? I mean, what happens if conditions get really bad And we start talking to each other about some of the terrible things that Washington, D.C. is going to us. Are we going to be enemy combatants? Because the precedent has been set already for American citizens to be in prison indefinitely. This is why we should protect the civil liberties of all suspects, and we shouldn't be putting people in prison in secret rendition and without a trial, without due process, without an attorney, and then on top of that, add on torture. That, to me, is not what America is all about. So these fears that I have and that you may have is connected to the economic system, because if the economic system breaks down, then there's going to be more challenges. People, after most Americans endorse the idea that after 9/11, oh, we're under attack. What do you want us to do? And just so many times I would hear, even if going through the lines at the airport, well, if this is what it takes, you know, we have to give up some of our freedoms to be free. And, you know, it was said a while ago, which I strongly endorse, that you don't have to give up your liberties to be free. Matter of fact, if you give them up, you can't be free. And yet a lot of people believe that. And if we have turmoil in this country, the same thing is going to happen. Yes, there will be a lot of poverty and a lot of problems and law and order breakdown. And they say, well, do whatever you can to make us safe and secure. Governments can't make you safe and secure. Do you think you're safe in your house because there's a policeman guarding your house? You're probably more safe in your house because of the Second Amendment than you are because of a policeman. But because of the threat and the undermining of our civil liberties and the possibility of losing the right of habeas corpus, and the potential of our system breaking down, this is why the monetary system is so important. The monetary system is connected.